Well, we will start with the text today. Chapter 6 of the Mother. Well, we have had a broad introduction to the concept of the Mother as seen in tradition, especially in India. And then we have discussed a little bit about the four powers as they are known, and also the ontological position of the Mother according to the divine plan that Sri Aurobindo has given us. So where exactly does the Divine Mother or Aditi come in the plan of creation? And of that, for that I had used a diagram done by Sri Aurobindo in January 1927, and we had seen that the Mother comes, the Aditi or the Mother comes as the third absolute, the first one being Tat, the transcendent, the second one was a Sat, Satchidananda, and third is Aditi. I am reminding you of this position of the Mother because we are going to come across that concept in this very paragraph. And I think those of you who do not have a copy of this divine plan, I would suggest either you download from your computers, from the internet, it is SAB, the collected works. Those who cannot do that, I have some extra copies here for you to study and keep them with you. They are with me, you can take them later. Now the very first sentence, the four powers of the Mother are four of her outstanding personalities, portions and embodiments of her divinity, through whom she acts on her creatures, orders and harmonizes her creations in the worlds, and directs the working out of her thousand forces. For the Mother is one, but she comes before us with different aspects. Many are her powers and personalities, many her emanations and vibhutis that do her work in the universe. In Sri Aurobindo's own words, who would explain the powers and appearances? What do we mean by four powers? Oh, by the way, these readings from Sri Aurobindo are again from collected works of Sri Aurobindo, and I think Linda has given me three copies here, spare copies. So this is a section on the significance of the Divine Mother, and I would request if you can download that and bring copies, because I will be using quite many quotations from this section 2 of the collected works of Sri Aurobindo. So I have just three copies of that. Those who are in dire need, if you do not have a laptop and a computer and internet, then you can take this. Otherwise, maybe you could bring your own copies. So this question of the powers of the Mother First, let us be clear about the notion of the powers. Because I can understand in other Semitic religions, this concept of the powers of the Divine Mother is quite non-existent in this manner. So what do we understand in the light of Sri Aurobindo and the Mother? And also, as I told you before, it has a lot to do with the Hindu philosophy itself. And of course, from Hinduism, this concept has gone to other philosophies that were born in India, like Buddhism, even Jainism. And Sri Aurobindo tells us about what are the powers and appearances. What do we understand by that? He says, these are the forces and beings that are interested in maintaining the falsehoods they have created in the world of the ignorance, and in putting them forward as the truth which men must follow. In India, they are termed asuras, rakshasas, pisachas, beings respectively of the mentalized vital, middle vital, and lower vital planes, who are in opposition to the gods, the powers of light. These too are powers, for they too have their cosmic field in which they exercise their function and authority. And some of them were once divine powers, the former gods, Purve Devaha, as they are called somewhere in the Mahabharata, who have fallen towards the darkness by revolt against the divine will behind the cosmos. The word appearances refers to the forms they take in order to rule the world. Forms often false and always incarnating falsehood, sometimes pseudo-divine. You see, this is a question maybe not directly relevant to what we have read in the first para. But Sri Aurobindo is giving a kind of a backdrop to understanding what are these divine powers. Because when we say the four powers of the Mother, are there exclusively these four powers? Or are there other powers in the world? Because the word power has been used for divine as well as asuric forces. So we have to be clear when we say the powers, because in English we have a common term called powers, but in Indian philosophy we have specific terms. When we say, like we have the word Satan, it is the undivine power. So in India, in Indian philosophy, all the undivine powers are classified, as he puts into, asuras, rakshasas, pisachas. Now you see, it is again interesting to see how each of these anti-divine or hostile forces have been again further classified. We don't just say satanic powers or dark forces. There is again a classification. As he puts it here, asuras are beings respectively of the mentalized vital. So basically we see that all these undivine or anti-divine forces belong to the vital world, not to the physical or the mental. So in this category of the vital, there is one force called asuras, which, as he puts it, as mentalized vital. That means where we have this vital force which is having a which has an influence of the mind, that's why he calls it the mentalized vital. However, it is always the vital beings, the vital forces what we get. And then there is the rakshasas, which is the middle vital. You know, as they come down from the mental, that is the asura. Well, we have talked about many times about the different asuras that are really having their play in the world. And of course, we have had a wonderful occasion of the mother vis-a-vis Hitler, the asura that was really guiding Hitler. Well, apart from that, in every culture and in every nation, we have these images of asuras as well as rakshasas. Now, rakshasa, when it comes to the middle vital, they are much more violent, more bloodthirsty, more, you know, terrifying. Then when it comes to the pisachas, the lowest one, which Sri Aurobindo calls as the lower vital planes, these beings are not only ugly, but they are really, you know, you can't even look at them, they are so ugly as that. So on the physical level itself, there's a tremendous amount of violence. So these are the three categories. The pisachas are the lowest ones, the rakshasas, the middle ones, and the asuras. Now, oftentimes somebody who has this asuras, they have a little qualification. They draw their energy from the divine. In fact, there's nothing non-divine in the world, the source of everything. Asuras and rakshasas, the source is the same one divine. And if you want to go back and say and see, the source is the same, the Aditi. Well, that is philosophically, we'll see later when we come to that. But one of the major differences between asuras and other forces, other powers, is that asuras are conscious of the divine. They draw their energy from the divine. But the only thing is, they have a tremendous vital ego. So they use the divine force and energy for their own purposes, for their own fulfillment. Otherwise, they are very powerful beings, but egotistic. So, to the extent that we in India use this term asura even for human beings who are egotistic, ego-centered, think themselves of endlessly of themselves only, we say he is asuric. So the term has come to be commonly used for human beings also. Now that's where Sri Aurobindo is telling us that these are in opposition to the powers of light. These two are powers, for they too have their cosmic field in which they exercise their function and authority, and some of them were once divine powers. This might remind some of you about Satan, that they were once with the divine. That means they were part of the divine plan. But once they go against, then they become these anti-divine forces. So he's saying, some of them were once divine powers, the former gods, purve devaha, who have fallen towards the darkness by revolt against the divine will behind the cosmos. It's a very similar one we have in Satan, that once you revolt against the divine, then you fall into darkness. You see, it's a very interesting concept which is applicable even to the human beings, that once we go against the will of the divine or act against his will, then what happens? We get into a darker consciousness. You see, I can understand now when we say surrender. What does surrender bring us? Basically, in line and in tune with the divine will and plan. that let thy will be done, as we say. So in this concept of let thy will be done, we are tuning ourselves to the divine factor. So that keeps us on the path, that makes us instrument. But if we act on the strength of our own ego, then we are obviously going most of the time against the divine will. That is why we are not able to feel the divine within us. Because we are at every moment, we don't call ourselves anti-divine and hostile. But on a smaller human level, we can see that if we do not fall in line with the divine, we are obviously becoming not against the divine, but definitely we lose the touch of the divine. So this whole process of surrender is nothing but this, that instead of going against him, we go according to his will and plan. That is what is yoga and sadhana. So he says, tells us that this is the revolt of the forces against the divine. Now there is a second letter. This is, I'm quoting from SABCL 25, page 62. I'm still in the word powers and emanations because we have come across both these terms. The use of the word power has already been explained. It can be applied to whatever or whoever exercises a conscious power in the cosmic field and has authority over the world movement or some movement in it. But the four of whom you speak are also shaktis, manifestations of different parts of the Supreme Consciousness and Force, the Divine Mother, by which she rules or acts in the universe. And they are at the same time divine personalities, for each is a being who manifests different qualities and personal consciousness forms of the Godhead. All the greater gods are in this way personalities of the divine, one consciousness playing in many personalities. Ekam Sat Bahudha. Even in the human being, there are many personalities and not only one, as used formally to be imagined. For all consciousness can be at once one and multiple. Powers and personalities simply describe different aspects of the same being. A power is not necessarily impersonal, and certainly it is not avyaktam, as you suggest. On the contrary, it's a manifestation acting in the worlds of the divine manifestation. You see, these are, you may normally understand, I know the word power, but you can see how many layers are there to understand one single word. Now, that was the first one that we discussed, was the powers that went against the divine, so we call them anti-divine powers or asuras, etc. Now, coming to this word power in the context of this Ashwamedha called the four powers or the mother, there's an interesting phrase here, but the four of whom you speak are also shaktis, manifestations of different powers of the Supreme Consciousness and Force, the Divine Mother, by which she rules. You see, he brings in the word shaktis now. So the powers are not on the one level, they are this anti-divine forces, we can call powers as forces. But on the other level, he says they are shaktis. And he also uses the word manifestations of the different powers of the Supreme, and they are at the same time divine personalities. You see, what we see here, in that formula of what we have seen, Sat, Chit and Ananda, we have seen that this Chit is the consciousness, which becomes the manifestation. Now here, there is another accompanying word
called tapas.
So Sri Aurobindo clarifies it further, saying Sat, Chit, Tapas and Ananda.
And tapas is what we say normally force, energy or Shakti.
So this is where the word Shakti is coming in. So when Sri Aurobindo is telling us but the four of whom you speak are also Shaktis, manifestations of different parts of the Supreme Consciousness. So this Supreme Consciousness now develops into different personalities or aspects. Like we have, you know, wisdom or harmony or power or perfection. And you know, afterwards we know 12 names of these perfections or personalities. So these are, each one of them, a personality. And of course you know the meaning by personality. That is, this is a person, persona, who embodies one of the characteristics here. So, the Divine Mother, she spreads herself into different divine characteristics. You see, each one of also, as he gives an explanation later in the same para, he says, even in the human beings, there are many personalities and not only one, as used formally to be imagined, for all consciousness can be at once and multiple. So there is this multiple personality even in us. He's telling human beings are not just compassion, are not just anger, are not just lust. It's a mixture of all this. And yet, we are all one person having multiple sides, but dominated by one of them. Now, why do I say dominated by one of them? This is where the Bhagavad Gita comes into picture. What they have called as the gunas, sattva, rajas and tamas. You see, this is interesting because we see the Vedas, the Upanishads and the Gita, if they are put together, it's only then that we can get a complete meaning of Indian philosophy. And especially when we come to Sri Aurobindo, we need to have a basic understanding of the Vedas, Upanishads and especially the Bhagavad Gita. So I'm borrowing the idea from the Gita to tell us that each one of us, he says, is dominated by one of these qualities. The sattva is the light, rajas is energy and tamas is inertia. So that is, on the outer personality, we have either a sattvic guna, that means we have an orientation towards sattva, that means knowledge, search of light, etc. Or some people, they believe more in energy, action, result, you know, the dynamism of the external action. And the third one, the tamas, is inertia, is complete physical and mental laziness. Now, the Bhagavad Gita tells us that we have a combination of all of them, but we are dominated by one of them. Each one of us, we can say, he is sattvic guna, she is rajas guna, the person is tamasic guna. So they also speak of the combination of different personalities, but dominated by one. So we come similarly to Sri Aurobindo, that the one human personality is divided into many of these personalities, but dominated by either wisdom or harmony or power or perfection, whom he would call as Maheshwari, Mahalakshmi, Mahakali, etc. Those four powers. So I think I touched upon this point last time, that all of us, we have a combination of these four powers: wisdom, power, harmony and perfection. But it is again, as we said here, dominated by one major aspect. So we are either the aspect of Maheshwari or Mahakali or Mahalakshmi or Mahasaraswati. And this is what is the meaning of integral yoga. It is to manifest all the four of them equally. You see, as Gita says, I may have grown with one particular swabhava, that of wisdom, that I am really all the time in pursuit of wisdom. But in yoga, in integral yoga, we say no, you have to develop other personalities also, that of harmony, perfection and power. So this is where integral yoga comes into picture, saying do not be satisfied or let not your growth be stifled with only one personality. You see, in the past, as we said in our last class, so we said that we have got to have all these four personalities. Now coming back to the sentence, Sri Aurobindo also is telling us that the divine is basically one. The Aditi, the consciousness, the supreme consciousness is one, but she manifests into different personalities, and these are the four personalities that we are going to take up in our text now. And he would say, so here is a sentence: they are at the same time divine personalities, for each is a being who manifests different qualities and personal consciousness forms of the divine. Now after this, I'd like to take you to the next sentence.